Lisa Law, Neal Hitch, thanks so much to both of you for joining me on New Mexico in Focus.
Oh, you're welcome. It's a freezing cold.
So Woodstock has been analyzed, scrutinized, celebrated, and picked over since people picked up their blankets and left Max Yazger's farm 55 years ago. So Neal, what prompted you to want to add to the already massive collection of information and media on Woodstock? And why did you choose oral history as the vehicle?
Yeah, well, there is a lot of information, and certainly there's been interview after interview from the 25th and the 40th and the 50th. Having an interview on a newspaper or on a program like this is different than talking about Woodstock in a deep form oral history method where the transcription will be saved, collected, cataloged, included in a database and saved at a museum, like preserved. What we're after is we want to preserve the stories. And though, I mean, there's been a lot of books written for sure, what we really are after as a museum is to preserve the actual authentic stories of people who attended. Often a book will be written from a perspective. And when you're doing a memory, a recollection of this event, especially now, looking with a 50-year lens of how that has affected your life or how you see attending Woodstock coming through the rest of your life, that the oral histories we're doing are really quite amazing.
The beautiful thing about oral history, really, from someone's own perspective. So Neal has been cruising the country, gathering these stories from Florida to Massachusetts to New York, and Santa Fe made the list of places to gather some of these stories from folks. Lisa, how did Santa Fe get in the mix? And was it always an obvious choice to you?
I think Santa Fe was one of the first choices because that's where the hog farm came from. Stan Goldstein came here in 1969 during the summer solstice and hired Hugh Romney and the hog farm to come out and take care of the people that were going to be coming to the concert and people who were going to probably take too much acid. And we all went, 100 of us went in an American Airlines jet. And when we got there, we realized that we better feed them too, because they didn't have anything lined up to feed them. So the reason he came here first, and we did 42 people last year here, was because most of the hog farm were still here. Plus, a lot of people moved here after Woodstock.
Gotcha. So it does make perfect sense that Santa Fe would be a good spot. So Woodstock is so singular for so many reasons. And of course, we don't have time to get to all of those here. But I'm interested in this. Maybe more than any other event in American history, people who were at Woodstock like to talk about Woodstock. Neal, why is that?
You know, one of the questions we ask is if your story has been, you know, part of your life. And so for sure, I mean, it is a cultural touchstone, right? I mean, it is dots the end of the 60s, a decade of turmoil. You know, a lot of the people were transitioning from high school or college into adult life. Woodstock becomes very defining for many reasons. One is, you know, the movie comes out, everyone sees the movie, it you know, wins awards, and it becomes part of just the cultural zeitgeist of the nation. So I'm sure, like, in 70 movie comes out, your friends see it and they say, did you go to Woodstock? And since that day, I always ask, is this like the Thanksgiving story that your children are tired of hearing of now? At the same time, when, you know, we do an oral history with someone, there is the story that they've told all the time. But what happens is we begin asking questions or thinking through some, you know, who you were as a young adult, like what your hopes and goals for the future were, like what, you know, what became of your life. People really have today a perspective that's very different than they would have given, again, when they were younger. It's also, I found people remember a lot more than they think. So they'll say, I don't really remember that much. And then the minute they start talking about it, you can see the synapses just keep going backward and backward. And they start having very vivid memories of this festival. I think, and one of the things that's kind of amazing is it is an event that was in a way kind of traumatic, in a way kind of an expression of joy, kind of this thing that can't be repeated. And so people remember being there because it was such an unusual event.
Lisa, what kind of themes, if there have been any, have emerged in Santa Fe in particular as you've gathered these stories? Or is it more all over the place than that?
What kind of themes?
Themes. What kind of themes?
Well, mainly the question I always ask people when I found them was, where did you eat? And because a lot of people didn't take anything to the festival, took a few things. And the three concessions that were available ran out of food by Friday night because they couldn't get any more in. And so when we arrived, I looked around and I said, whoa, there's a lot of people here. What are we going to do? And our group said, well, we'll go get some pots and pans and some rice. And I said, I think it's going to be more than that. Let me go ask the producers if they could give me some money and Peter White Rabbit, and I'll go into town and get some stuff. And he eventually gave me $6,000 altogether. And we went in and bought bulgur wheat, 1,200 pounds of bulgur wheat, 1,200 pounds of rolled oats and almonds and currants and sunflower seeds and brewer's yeast and honey and soy sauce. And when I came back with Peter, we bought fields of people's vegetables. And so what I found, when I asked the question, what did you eat? They said, I starved to death. Or they said, we went over to the hog farm. Some guy we're going to interview in a couple of days here, Carl, he said that he was sleeping behind one of the buses that were in the free stage, and he'd get up every morning and go eat what the hog farm was feeding. He ate the whole time from the hog farm. So that's the main thing that I talk about is, how did you eat? Because what we found out was, it's if they hadn't eaten in those last 2 days, Saturday and Sunday, they wouldn't have been as happy campers as they were. They became really happy campers because we fed 200,000 people. So that's one of the main things. And then I asked them, which music do you remember? Or did you go swimming in the nude in the lake? And did you go to the arts and crafts area? And where did you sit? And did you get up from those seats? And where did you camp? So people have been waiting to tell this story so they're remembered. That's what I'm finding out, is they want to tell this story. And they're so happy that somebody's really caring about coming out here and documenting them. It's just a beautiful thing to see. So this year, I got about 10 people. And then I said, that's not enough. So what I did was, is I got interviewed by the New Mexican who put in a story. Here's the story right here about me looking for new people. And another 9 people, I think, signed up. So we have 19 ready to be interviewed on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. So Neil's coming in with his crew, and he's going to be the one that interviews them. And I'm just going to help produce the event by getting them in and out of the room and showing them pictures. I've got to show you this.
Very cool.
I want to show you this.
Well,
this is the picture. One of the pictures will show them. And this is I took this from a helicopter.
Cool.
Then they point out, oh, I was sitting over there. That's where I was. So they get very excited because they get to see themselves or where they were.
Outstanding. Okay. Yeah. So, Neal, once you've collected all these stories, how do you envision people interacting with this project?
Yeah, in 2020, coming out of COVID, we started getting a lot of contact from people who've been sitting at home thinking about their memories. And so we developed what we call the Oral History Initiative, which was really moving some of our staffing capacity from kind of the jobs they had done prior to COVID to really collecting the oral histories and managing the data. So at the end of that process, we, you know, we're starting to talk now about, you know, it's a lot of data. So we're transcribing audio. We have audio, video, and then the transcriptions. And what we'll move into is beginning to catalog and coordinate this as an archive, and eventually, you know, a searchable, accessible archive. But you know, the vision is someday it'll be keyword searchable. You can come and type in hog farm free kitchen, and you'll get every story that, you know, will pop up of anyone that talked about eating at the hog farm free kitchen, for instance. So we're beginning to work on that. When we do the transcription, we're beginning to highlight keywords and things like that. But the steps of creating an accessible database is going to take as much time as collecting the data. And, you know, if we don't record the stories, then the archive is non-existent. So we've really, really been focused on as many stories as possible and putting all of our capacity into getting people's memories. What I say is, even if we have a meeting, like I get asked this a lot, any meeting we sit in that's talking about what's going to happen in the future is a memory that's lost to history, because we are not out recording that. So it's been quite a process, and we will continue as we can.
Very cool. Before I shift gears a little bit, I want to ask you both just very briefly, what are you listening to these days, music-wise? Neal, you first.
I've been listening to this band called Gorilla Toss. They've been around for about 10 years. They put an album out, but I've been privileged enough at my contacts here at Bethel Woods Center for the Arts to hear some of the music they're actively recording now for their new album. And I've brought them in for a couple things that we've done with younger. I work in a sphere of 60s music, but I am really interested in the emerging styles of music that come next. And so I really try to listen to some stuff that is really new.
Awesome. Lisa, what are you listening to?
Well, I just went to hear Nosotros the other night, which is a local band, and it's salsa, and I went dancing to it with my son and Jesse, and it was fantastic. But, you know, I'm still into the old music, like Bob Dylan, Santana, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, Janis Joplin. I'm totally into those people, because that's my era. And I documented all those people. I mean, I have one of the best pictures taken of Bob Dylan. So I when I listen to music, that's who I listen to. And the new groups, not so much.
Okay. I do love Nosotros, so I'm a little jealous that you went to the show the other night. Now I am going to change gears just a little bit. In Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, Hunter Thompson wrote about a sense of inevitable victory over the forces of old and evil. He wrote about riding the crest of a high and beautiful wave, and then being able to see the wave's high water mark just a few years later. Of course, Hunter was writing about San Francisco in the mid to late 60s. But Lisa, I wonder, was Woodstock sort of a high water mark in the same way?
Well, for me, Woodstock was the most important event of my life, you know, because I thought I was just going to a concert when I got there and realized if we didn't take control of what was going to go on and take care of the people that were on acid and take care of the people that were cold and wet or cut their foot or when they were hungry, it wasn't going to turn out good. And that's why Stan Goldstein hired us. He knew that we knew how to do that because we were a commune. Okay. So from then on, everything I dealt with, I mean, I'm known now. I mean, here's a local Santa Fe magazine talking about Woodstock. Okay. Now I'm even known more than I was before because they're realizing that I'm the one who went out and bought all that food. And as history goes, because people are getting older and young people are coming up and want to know what's happening. And the older people are getting really old, but they remember what they really liked. I'm the same way. I love being there with all those people who are just sharing with each other, sitting in the mud, sharing their plastic over their head, sharing their food. And they'd keep their seat while they went over and got some food or went to the Port-a-Sands and came back. That kind of stuff is important to those people. Those people, they're like brothers. As soon as I can walk into a restaurant in Tasuki and say, who went to Woodstock? And people raise their hand like this. I mean, we're part of the same family. That's what we are. And then we're easily talk to each other. So it's like hippies wearing beads. If you say Woodstock, people want to hear what you have to say and they want to tell you their story.
Indeed. So Neal, going back to the metaphor of the way Hunter described this in Fear and Loathing, assuming that Woodstock was sort of a high water mark, why did the wave roll back? And why is it important to remember its peak 55 years later?
Well, one is, I think that, look, I'm a historian, so history comes in peaks and waves and valleys, right? Like that's been the history of human experience. What I would say though is, yeah, I think that for like when we do these oral histories, there's a pretty clear kind of through line from most people, which is they experienced this 3 days of peace, love, and music, which was a high watermark for the movement. Did may have been the top of a wave, but what they've carried with them for the rest of their life is that there is those waves come and go, and there's hope that wave is in the future, that there's hope for peace and love, and there's hope that like we can ride a wave of, you know, peace and music and maybe hit another 3 days. You know, I think all of our hope is that we would move toward a human existence that was peace and love. Me personally, I'd love if we moved toward, you know, a human existence that was peace, love, and music. But that happened in the past. And again, I think that for many of the people that experienced Woodstock, their big takeaway is it can happen and there's hope for the future.
I want to talk a little.
Add something to that.
Please.
The museum at Bethel Woods is really important that that happened because you can go there at the place that the concert was held and the lawn is pristine and on top is this beautiful museum that shows what really happened. It tells a story and they show the movie and then there's a place for music off to the side and lots of groups are coming there now and playing music every weekend. So you could come and see the museum and then you could go hear some music. And that's wonderful because a lot of people are coming back into that community because of the museum. So it's fantastic that that's happening. And Neil's running it right now and he's doing a great job. And he put on an event this last year honoring the hog farm and feeding everybody. And they had me going around showing where I designed the kitchen and the food booths and feeding them muesli. So, and it's going to be happening this year too. So he's really doing a great job of bringing all those memories back and showing the people what really happened.
I want to talk a little bit. I want to stay with you, Lisa, and talk a little bit about some of what's changed since Woodstock. And I want to kind of get into the political movement that fueled Woodstock, very much characterized by pro-free speech, anti-war, deep skepticism of American law enforcement and intelligence institutions, essentially what we used to call the American left. How has the American left changed since then? And do you recognize it now?
Well, what's happening right now, the American left is way over to the right. That's what I'm seeing. And I'm seeing a lot of lying going on with the people that are running for president. And I'm really sick and tired of it, to tell you the truth. So I am campaigning for Robert F. Kennedy Jr. because he's the only one who's going to get us back to that place where we were in the 60s and taking care of each other and honoring each other and trying to have good health and bring the troops home and no wars and balancing things out so that love and peace exists again, because right now it's a battleground out there. And you can't tell who's telling the truth anymore. So the only one I see telling the truth is Robert F. Kennedy Jr. And I've got magnets all over my cars of his picture and campaigning for him, because that's the feeling I had during the 60s. And that's how it was at Woodstock. And I feel that if people don't understand that they've been put on. You know, they've been lied to. And I don't think that the people should be lied to. I think we should all take care of each other. I mean, we've spent $60 billion in the Ukraine, and we could have built houses for every homeless person there is in the United States. Why aren't we taking care of our own people? That was the message from the 60s and from Woodstock, taking care of each other instead of, that's my seat, that's my food. Everybody was sharing, and that's why it became the Woodstock generation. And I would like to see the Woodstock generation come back. And we have to have a good leader to do that. And we can't be lied to all the time.
I want to kick that question to you a little bit and phrase it slightly differently. We've talked about the philosophies and the political movements. How have the people who attended Woodstock changed in 55 years?
Are you asking me?
I was asking Neal.
Oh, good.
Oh, you know, one is, as you get older, life changes. You have children, right? You get a job. Many of us move into becoming our parents in a way. At the same time, I think many of the core beliefs that members of the counterculture had, I think our oral history certainly will showcase that they continued to hold those beliefs through their lives. And even though they move into the workplace and they move into family and other things, that what they choose to do for a living and how they go about their life and how they take ideas of hope, caring for people. I've talked to people who, you know, experienced caring for, I just talked to a gentleman the other day who came to Woodstock as a high school senior, volunteered in the medical tent, talking to people that were having what he said, almost like he felt mental health crisis, though it wasn't called that then. And as he dropped out of college, you know, was involved in some activism and some protests, and then said, you know, what I remember from Woodstock is that I'm pretty good at caring for people. And he spent 33-year career in working in mental health in the state of New Jersey. And what he said is like that, I had a successful career following what my core beliefs that I held at Woodstock. And I think for a lot of people that's kind of like that. I'd also say that the counterculture, like a lot of things that we experience every day, right? Those changed the culture of America. Like that, they wanted not to live in the culture of their parents, and we certainly do not live in the culture of the 50s today. There may be a lot of polarization, but there was a lot of great legislative change that came out of the 60s and in the 70s. And many of those programs that were directly reflected from core beliefs of the counterculture are the programs and that we live with today.
So tell me a little bit about the event coming up in Santa Fe. When is it? Where is it? And what are y'all looking for?
Yeah, so we have a location where we're doing oral histories. Typically, when we do an oral history, someone will have signed up, like they contact us, and they contact us through either the website at BethelWoodsCenter.org or through oralhistory@BethelWoodsCenter.org. And we have a process where, you know, we get some information from you. We offer you some slots on a schedule. There's some flexibility of you choose something, and then we connect with you to get you there at a certain time. Oral history typically lasts for about an hour. That's probably about 30 minutes of an oral history. And then, you know, we getting you in a chair and getting you out of a chair and things like that take some time. So we typically have an hour slot that you would schedule. Everything we do is pre-scheduled. But if you contact us, we still have some room available in this pop-up, which will happen this Thursday and Friday. But we also do probably 1/3 of the oral histories we do remotely through Zoom. And that we do almost every day. So you're welcome to do that. Also, if anyone wants to come to the site, we do oral histories at the site, again, almost every day. So we have multiple ways of connecting with us and multiple ways of ensuring that your story will be preserved in this museum.
Very cool. Neal, Lisa, thanks so much for coming on and talking to me about this.
Yeah, if they want to contact us, if they haven't already signed up for these 3 days, they can call me up or email me right away at lisajolaw@icloud.com, and I will slip them into a open slot for them, because we do have a few extra spaces.
Fantastic. Thanks again to both of you.
All right. Thanks so much.
Yeah. Take care.
Thank you.